So, you know, the basic idea behind CO2 storage is that you take compressed carbon dioxide, which is a liquid at the surface, and by the time you pump it underground, it's a supercritical fluid, and its density is about 2/3 of the density of the water. So it's buoyant. So when you put it underground, what you're going to be relying on is the presence of a type of rock formation that we would call a seal. And the seal is exactly like it sounds. It's a seal, meaning that the CO2 can't escape. And seals are rocks, they're shale, it was very typically, or anhydrite salt would be another good one. So the basic physics and chemistry of CO2 storage, you know, in underground formations is very, very well established, you know, through and built upon our understanding of why oil and gas formations actually accumulate where they do from related disciplines like soil science and so forth. So the basic physics of this are really very, very well established. So then there's the question, it's like, okay, you know, in nature, if you find the right place, it should work. So then there's the question as well, can we, you know, create engineering infrastructure that allows us to safely put it in the rock under that seal? And again, here's another area where we have a lot of experience with drilling wells, and in particular, injection wells, where you need to do an extra good job of making sure that the cement seal that connects the well to the rock around it is really good quality. But again, we can do that. We also have ways to measure, did we really do a good job? And all of that's required for a typical geologic storage project. So, you know, in the right location, you know, this is really very straightforward, and the risks are really very low. You know, there's always the possibility that, you know, particularly when you go to an area with new type of rocks that you haven't studied, you haven't worked in that location, that, you know, it takes a lot of work to characterize the rocks, to make sure that that seal is continuous and that you have a good reservoir and it's big enough. Now, this is something that geoscientists do all the time. Exploration geologists, you know, this is their bread and butter. But it does take work. And it could be possible that there was something that you missed, which is why you need to monitor these projects. This is definitely not, you know, out of sight, out of mind. 20 years ago, I was talking to a reporter, and I thought I'd done such a nice job of describing to him what this was all about. And the headline came out, "Sweeping Carbon Dioxide Under the Rug." I was just mortified. So the point is that, it's not sweeping it under the rug. You have to monitor it, and you have to show you know where it is. You have to show that it's not leaking. Again, those are technologies that we have available. So again, there are many assurances, you know, built into the process. You have to get permits in order to do this. And every year as part of the permits, you have to report data to the government, you know, showing that the project is complying. When I talk with the public, there's often a concern it's going to leak back out into the atmosphere. Again, if you have a good site, that's not going to happen. And there have also been a lot of very detailed studies from my group and many others saying, okay, well, what if we did a really bad job and that there was, you know, the seal wasn't as good as we thought it was. And if you look at the leakage rates under those circumstances, even where you have a poor seal, you know, they're extremely low. They're on the order of, say, 1% per year. And again, if you had a leak anywhere near that big, it would be very clear from your monitoring data. So really, no matter how you look at it, the risks are understood. There are government controls in place to oversee these projects. And even in the event that something does go wrong, there are many approaches you can use to basically remedy the situation.